Well, first off, thank you, everybody. Thank you, Jesus, for just bringing us all together. And just I'm really excited for the message that's going to be shared tonight. If you guys have been following any of the messages that have been done in the past, I kind of build on each one. I believe in a principle of precept upon precept. And the last one that we talked about is receive it and keep it. Basically that God, he says in his word that he says that whatever you ask and you believe, you shall receive. But then we have an enemy who tries to snatch it out. And so that whole message was basically about understanding that when we receive something, that we've got to keep it. We've got to continually keep our mind focused on it. We've got to continually just keep focused on the fact that what we asked for, that God has given us. But then the enemy tries to do a couple little tricks, and he tries to do it inside of the mind. He comes against the mind. He says, tries to get us to focus on the things that we don't have instead of the things that we do. He tries to get us focused on our condemnation, basically the fact that, you know, we're not all powerful, that we're weak, that, you know, who are we to think that we could do anything for God's kingdom, right? And so he tries to get us continually focused on our flesh, tries to get us continually focused on the things that we don't have or the things that we're not, instead of the things that Jesus Christ is and the thing that Jesus Christ has given us. You see, at the cross, everything was finished. Jesus Christ said it. He said when he was on the cross, he said, "It is finished." And the moment that it was finished, all grace was empty out. And we access this by faith. So if you just take a minute and we just apply this principle, we say, okay, on the cross, Jesus died. And when he died, all grace at that moment was emptied out. The veil was torn so that we could be fully with God and God could be fully with us. However, we access this grace that God's given us, this ability, by faith itself. And faith, and we know from 11:1, Hebrews 11:1 says that faith is the evidence of things not seen, the conviction of things hoped for. So we can't actually see the things. We're looking into a spiritual world and we're saying, yes, I believe that I have received it. Even though I don't see it in my physical world, I am going to seize that. I am going to receive that. I'm going to hold on to that. And I'm going to operate from that place and not to that place. See, Romans 8:32 says, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things?" You see, so I want you to think to yourself or say to yourself, I have all things. Jesus Christ has given me all things. But the doorway that we enter, you'll notice here in Romans 8:32, the doorway we enter into this access of all things is the love of God. Because it says, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all." You see, so it's that realization, that understanding that God has given up his own son, the very most precious thing that he could possibly give up. You see, you're more precious than anything that is contained in this world because God gave up the most precious thing that he had. He gave it up in the spiritual sense. He gave it up in a mental sense, a physical sense. He gave it up in the all-encompassing sense. He said, "I am going to give up something that's more precious than gold and silver. I am going to give up my son itself, himself, so that you might come into alignment with me." You see, Jesus didn't just die so that we could get to heaven, but that so heaven could get into us. And there comes this place, we start to get this understanding when we enter through this doorway that, wow, God really loves me. God has got a great call. He's got a great purpose. And nothing that the enemy tries to throw on top of me is going to work. Now, there is a call. There is something that we have to do, and that's called renewing of the mind. But to see the understanding of this renewing of our mind does not mean that we have to try to get to something, but that we have to accept that we already have something. And the more that we understand that we've accepted it, or the more that we accept what we have, the more that we start operating from the place of abundance instead of to the place of abundance. But the only way we can get in there, remember this, Romans 8:32, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things?" You see, God loves you so much, so absolutely much, that he came down in the flesh, lived the perfect life that we possibly could never have lived, and he did everything necessary, was beaten beyond recognition so that we might have an identity in him. His body was bruised and wounded beyond any compare so that we might be able to be free and healed beyond any compare. You see, there is an exchange that took place when Jesus Christ came and he said, "Take me and not him." He said, don't take my followers. Don't take the ones that I love. Don't take them. Take me instead. And on that exchange, in that moment, we died. The Bible tells us that we die the moment that we believe. We die with Christ on the cross and we are reborn in the Spirit. You see, Jesus said the only way that we can enter into the kingdom or see the kingdom is if we've been born again. And that exchange took place the moment that we believe in Jesus Christ. But there's this process, and it's in our mind, and it's an understanding in our mind saying, well, am I the new or am I the old? Now, the Bible tells me that I'm the old man, or that the old man died. And he tells me that I'm a new man. Says that I have a new wineskin, so that way I might be filled up with new wine. But can I see it? Is it something that I can tangibly feel? Can I look at my life and can I see this change that's occurred as soon as it's happened? Can I see it? Can I feel it? You see, that's why we have to access it by faith. Because faith says, even if I can't see it yet, I believe that God is not a liar, that God is willing to give me all things, just like he says here in Romans 8:32, and that he's able to, through the sacrifice of his son, he took all the sin on top of him so that I might have all the grace on top of me. And there's this place that we say, you know what, I'm going to start operating from the place of abundance, and I'm not going to try to get into the place of abundance. You see, Jesus Christ, God himself, the Spirit of God, he is with you fully. And anytime that we ask him for more, which we all very often do, we say, God, I want more of you, right? We're continually saying, you know what, God, I just want more. Just fill me up, Lord, I want more, I want more. You see, all that happens in that moment is that we get a renewing in our mind to what he's already done. You see, God has already done all things on the cross, and the access with which we seize it is through faith. The access through which we receive it is through a precept upon precept principle that it starts breaking away the mind. It starts breaking away this looking of thinking that I'm the old man and I'm not the new man. You see, Ephesians 3 tells us that the more that we accept his love for us, the more that it fills us with his Spirit. You see, the more that we access through the door that God has given up his son for us, the more that we say, Jesus, wow, you love me so much. You've done so much for me. And I just worship your holy name. And we come to him in a place of thanksgiving. And we come to him from a place of praise. And we just enter into the gates. And we enter into the courts. And we start walking in this new aliveness. We start walking in this new awareness, this new alignment with the kingdom of God. And we just start praising. And we just start thanking. This, my friends, is how we come into the renewing of the mind. You see, renewing of the mind is this process of saying, you know what? God has done the finished work for me. See, the enemy tries to put us in this place of condemnation. You see, there's a battleground going on here. And the battleground is in our mind. The battleground is where the enemy tries to come against us and he tries to get us to look at things. He tries to say, you know what? Get out of the place of faith and get into the place of confusion. Get out of the place where you're trying to judge what God's word by your own experiences. Get out of that place and start focusing on the things that you don't have instead of what God's done for you. Romans 12 verse 1 and 2 says, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And a lot of people will stop there and say, you know, that's powerful. And then they put whatever they want in there and they say, oh, you're not, you know, you have to start presenting your bodies as a living sacrifice. And they, you know, they put on smoking and they put on, you know, eating healthy. And they say that you're not doing it because you're not presenting your bodies as a living sacrifice. But if we move forward through this, we see here that it says your spiritual worship is do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. You see, there's a process that the enemy tries to use with the world, or the world will actually just try to do it to you. It tries to conform you. It tries to say, you know what, you fit into the mold. If you've ever felt like the world's trying to get you to fit into a mold, you're completely correct. And that mold is one of, you know what, I have to live in lack. I have to live in lies. My God, you know, he loves me, but only if I follow all these little steps and rules that he tells me to do. You know, the truth of the matter is that Jesus Christ transformed us. He transformed us so that we might joyfully do the things he's calling us to do. You know, there comes a place that you say, you know what? I don't have to read my Bible. I get to read my Bible. I don't have to listen to praise and worship songs. I get to listen to praise and worship songs. I don't have to live by the grace of God. I get to live by the grace of God. And we start getting to this place of, I have to, I get to. And it's an exciting place. It's basically saying, you know what, I am so stoked up, so excited, so fired up, because I got a God that loves me, that's with me 100% of the time, 24/7. He's not just with me in my prayer closet. He's not just with me when I open up the Bible. He's with me 100% of the time. In fact, the Bible tells us that even our work is as if glorifying God. And so we stop compartmentalizing God. We stop putting him in little shoe boxes and saying he's only with me when I'm at church. You are church. You bring church everywhere you go. As soon as you talk to somebody who's a believer, and you start agreeing with them, and you start praying with them, and you start talking to them, and encouraging them, and building them up, and edifying, and you start seeing the finished work of God inside of them, and you work from a place of grace, as soon as you start talking into that place, you're in church, my friends. You're in church. Brothers and sisters, you're in church, and God is with you. God is with you 100% of the time. And so there comes a time when the world will try to conform you, tries to put you into this mold. It tries to say, this is what you got to do, right? And I did a message a little while ago. I was talking about a Christian versus being a child of God. A Christian is everything that we do. Being a child of God is everything that we are. We are not loved by worth, but by birth. We are accepted by a new birth. Not by worth. There's absolutely nothing that we can do to get into the good graces of God. To even think that is itself just a pride. To think that we could possibly clean ourselves up enough or do anything possibly enough and then say, okay, God, now I'm worthy of your acceptance. Okay, God, you know what? I've done everything that you told me to do. I read my Bible today for 30 minutes. I patted some guy on the back and showed him some love. I smiled at a couple people I didn't know. And I even told some people, about the fact that I love you. And so, you know, today I've done enough and now you can accept me. Now you can love me. You see, that's craziness. But that's exactly the type of material that the enemy tries to throw in our mind. He tries to get us to look at the things that we've done instead of the thing that God did, which was the finished work of the cross. There's a reason why Jesus Christ said it's finished. So that any time the enemy tries to get you out of the approval or acceptance, he tries to make you look at what you're not. He starts saying, you know what? Hey, you better get off me, buddy, because it's been finished. So you better go bother my father because you're not going to come up against me because I'm God's holy temple. And we get into this place of receiving that God has done the transformed work. That the only reason that I can love, I can have joy, that I can praise, that I can have peace, the only reason I can have any of these things is not because I'm going to be able to muster enough strength, but because God has transformed me to be able to accept him, to be able to be acceptable by him, because I only love Jesus Christ because he loved me. See, there's no way possible that I could ever have loved God until he loved me first. That's in the Bible. That's in Scripture. But you don't ever hear your mind telling you those things, right? You don't ever hear your mind saying to you like, oh, well, you know, you only love God because God loves you. So the more that you understand that God loves you, the more you'll love God. And the more that you love God, the more that you're going to go out there and start exploding the kingdom everywhere you go. You see, Jesus Christ told us very clearly. He said, here's what you're going to do. Here's how you're going to pray. I want you to pray that the kingdom should come, right? He says, our Father who art in heaven, thy kingdom come, thy will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. You see, so first off, we have to realize how awesome God is. Hallowed be thy name, separated, unique, holy. The very word holy means unique and set apart. It means that there's nothing like him. Then he turns around and he says, you will be holy as I am holy. So now we've been unique and set apart. Once again, we're not trying to operate into holiness, but we're operating from holiness. Once again, we're not trying to operate to the acceptance of God. We're operating from the acceptance of God. We're not trying to operate to this place that I could be everything that God is calling me to be, and all I got to do is write more notes to myself, and I got to beat myself up every single day. The reason why Paul beat his body daily was not because he had to, but because he wanted to. Because he was bound by the chains of love. Because he loved God so much that it brought him into the people. And the more that we understand God's love for us, the more that it brings us into the people. And the more that we go into the people, which is ourselves, brothers and sisters, the more we have to go to God to have something to give God. And it's just an awesome, amazing, powerful thing of what God has done. And so there comes a place that we say, you know what, I'm going to be transformed. I'm not going to be conformed. I'm going to be inside outside focused. I'm going to be focused on God. I'm going to tap into what God's got for me. I'm going to line up with his purpose and plans for my life. I realize that he changed my heart. Therefore, I got a new heart. You got a new heart. Let me just lay that out there right now. You've got a new heart. Therefore, the desires that you have in your heart are not wicked. The desires that you have in your heart, when you get transformed by God, they become a place that you basically align your desires with Christ's. And you start saying, you know what? I want to see my Father's kingdom be expanded. And so often the enemy tries to get us into a place of saying, I can't move forward. I don't know how. How do I move forward? I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. And Jesus says, just take a step. I'm going to be there with you. Just keep listening to my voice. If you're going in the wrong direction, I'll tell you to turn a little bit as you're stepping. And pretty soon you're going to do 180 degrees, but at least you're moving. And I just here to tell you right now that the enemy tries to keep us rooted in a place of fear. And it's all in the mind. It's all in the mind, trying to get us to focus on the things that we don't have, the things that we don't know, rather than what God has done for us and what God is doing in us every single day. We are continually being renewed. We are continually in alignment with the kingdom of God. And when we see something that God, the Spirit, when he says, you know what, go out there and just say hello, then all of a sudden we say hello. He says, now I want you to say this. Now I want you to pray for him. Now I want you to smile at him, right? And we just start moving into the grace of God. We start moving from the grace of God instead of to the grace of God. And there's a place that we've got to get to that says, you know what, I have received everything that God has called me to do. You see, the purposes and the plans and the desires that he's put in my heart, they are not evil. Yes, they might be different. They might be a unique expression of his kingdom here on this earth. But you know what? They're not evil when you've been transformed. And here's how you know you've been transformed. Bible tells us very clearly. It says that when you love the brothers and sisters, then that means that you love God. It says that when you know love and you can see it, right? That means you know God. And so we know God by love inside of us, which makes perfect sense considering the Bible tells us that God is love. It's very clear on that. It doesn't say God has love. It says God is love. In fact, one of the most powerful, most repeated things inside the Bible is that we should live in love, that we should be empowered by love, that we should know the love of God, and that it should flow outside of us. And then all of a sudden, the whole fruits make perfect sense because the fruits become expressions of love. They become expressions of love for the world around us. But until we realize that God loves us and we're in the acceptable good graces of God because of what he's done for me, and it's not necessarily what I'm going to do for God, then we're trying to get to the place of love instead of operating from it. And we've got to get to the place we say, you know what? I'm operating from this place. Now let's talk about the mind. I used to be attacked every single day with anxiety, fear, depression, and worry. I used to be attacked so much so that I believed that the next day I was going to die. I believed that in the next minute, sometimes it was so strong and I believed that all of a sudden I was going to hit by a car, I was going to drop dead from a heart attack. I used to have visuals and images in my mind that used to come against me. It used to scare the snot out of me so much so I couldn't even I just couldn't even respond or react in my daily life. I used to go into these like freezes. All of a sudden my body would lock up. My eyes would get all big and I would start to just basically my heart would start beating and I thought that I was about ready to die. And it came against me so much so. And there was one saying that really helped me so much during that time. And that saying was that fear knocks on the door, but faith answers and no one's there. And I believe that that's a really powerful saying that used to lock me up because it used to say, you know what? I don't care if I die. This is what would happen. I'd be like, I don't care if I die. If I die, I'm going to be with Jesus. And I answered that fear, that place of fear, that spirit of fear that tried to come against me. And I said, you know what? It doesn't matter what you try to bring on me because God's got good things in store for me. So therefore, you've got no dominion in my life. And I believe that that's something that we've really got to lock onto. We've got to realize that we do not need to come from a place, a spirit of fear. You see, so that this is a tool of the enemy, spirit of fear. You are not saved. And if you are saved, you're not going to be any use for the kingdom of God. Don't you remember what you did in the past? Don't you remember all those things that you did? You stole when you were younger. You did this. I mean, and it tries to get you into this place of looking at your past and saying this determines your future. But it doesn't. Your present or your past does not determine your future. The ability, God's grace has already determined your future. But we have to receive that and access that by faith, which means that we say, you know what, that's for me. And we start operating from that place instead of trying to get to that place. And I think that this is such a powerful and important word for us to really realize. that when we start saying, you know what, it's not about what I'm doing, it's about what God did, then when we get transformed, then we start moving from that place. I was talking to one of my brothers. We were talking about being organized, efficient, doing more for the kingdom of God. And he said, you know what, I got to start writing post-it notes all over the place, and I got to start keeping lists, and I got to start doing all these things so I could be more organized. And I said, stop. Just stop. I said, first off, those things are not going to make you organized. They're just going to they're just basically just solidifying the fact that you don't feel like you are. And now you're just heaping on all these things that you have to do in order to get to that place. And there's nothing that you can do to transform yourself. God already did it for you. In fact, my brother, you are organized, you are efficient, you are productive, because Jesus Christ gave you all things on the cross. And when you align yourself to that reality, then taking the notes and taking the post-it notes, that all just comes naturally. That just comes from a place of basically saying, you know what, this is who I am and this is what I'm going to do. And we've got to get away from this place of saying, of looking at the external, because the external does not change the internal. It will not transform it. I hear so often, I'll just be on my way. Sometimes I'll see it on Facebook. I'll hear people talking about it. And they got their hearts right. People got their hearts right. But it's just inside of me, this spirit of grace that's inside of me. I just hear like, you know, no, it's not right. And they're saying, you know, you're just doing this wrong. You're doing this wrong. And I can't, you know, don't you love the Lord? And if you love the Lord, you wouldn't be doing this. And basically they're just sitting there and they're just picking them apart and they're looking and they're just pointing out all the flaws. And they're saying, look, if you love the Lord, you wouldn't do those things. You see, that's not the problem. The problem is that they don't know the Lord loves them. You see, when we realize that the Lord loves us, it's the goodness and kindness of God that causes us to repent. Those people don't need to be knowing what they're not doing right or doing wrong. They need to know why the Lord loves them through those things. They need to understand that, look, I understand that you're trying to chase these things. You know, you're chasing women because you think that they're going to fill you up. But at the end of the day, it's just not going to work. And God knows that. And he died for you on the cross because he knows that the things that you're chasing can only be fulfilled in him. Haven't you ever been into a place when you have been worshiping, right? And you just start getting into this place. You start speaking from this place of fullness, this place of love. But you yourself have to operate from love in order to be able to give it. There is nothing that we can give that we have not received. There's absolutely nothing that we can give to the world that we ourselves have not been received ourselves. The only way that we have love to give is because God first loved us. The only way that we have anything to give is because God first loved us. And so we've got to get to the place where we say, you know what, I've received what God has for me. And when the enemy tries to come against me, he tries to make me focus on distractions, condemnations, and flaws. I say, you know what, I'm going to focus on God and his attractions, the things that he adds to me. I'm going to focus on convictions, the things that point to the cross. And I'm going to focus on his grace, which is his ability in me. You see, it's God's ability flowing through us that allows us to do everything that he's calling us to do. And if you believe, I mean, it's just so powerful. Like, he gave you the purpose. He gave you the vision. He gave you everything inside of you for you to be able to go out there and run your race. He's given you the eyes to see what people need. He's given you something that you're here. You're here for a reason. He made you. He made you exactly how you are. There was a problem and you're the solution. And he said, you know what? You're going to carry me. You're going to carry me into the world. I've locked something inside of you, a gift. Think about it like this. Gifts are made to be given. And God has put gifts inside of you that are made to be given. And while the enemy tries to get you to think that you're the old man, the weak, right? When he tries to get you to think that, he tries to make you believe that your past is going to determine your future. I say to you that Jesus Christ on the cross, the finished work, determines your future. So now let's take a look at this. Philippians 4:8. Philippians 4:8 says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. You see, we've already been given the blueprint for our mind. You know why we've been given a blueprint? You know why Paul said, you know what, these are the things that you need to be thinking about. Because we need a blueprint, because if we don't have some type of blueprint in our mind, then how do we have a discernment if whether or not this is of God or not? And we have right here a perfect blueprint. It says, finally, brothers, which means that he's talking to believers. So he says, finally, brothers, whatever is true. What is true? Jesus Christ is truth. Scripture is truth. The fact that God is love is truth. The fact that God loves you is true because he died for you on the cross. So what if we just stop there? What if we just say, you know what, whatever is true, let's stop there. How many thoughts right now in your head, let's take a mental audit, because I want you guys to see the strongholds of the enemy. I want you to see what the placement, the strategic placement that the enemy's trying to has had in your life over the years, and he's continually built it up. I want you to see where it might be at. Because when you realize where those strongholds are at, when you see the things that are trying to say that you're something different than what the scripture says, then you start breaking those things down. That's renewing of the mind. You see, renewing of the mind is focusing on the finished work of God. It's realizing that I have the mind of Christ. So anyway, so we have whatever is true, whatever is true. So start thinking like that. Whatever is true. This is your new mind filter. I'm giving you a mind filter. Whatever is true. Actually, I'm not Paul's. But whatever is true. So from now on, I want you to think in my head, is this true? Is this honorable? What is honor? Honor is basically preferring another person above yourself. It's basically saying, you know what, I honor you, right? You are welcome. I value you as a person, and speaking from a place of honor. So often we talk to people from a place of dishonor. We don't value them. We at the very least, we depreciate them instead of appreciating. You know, the ability of appreciating something means to see it as a higher value than it sees itself. To appreciate and value is a car that continually appreciates in value. Now, I want you to imagine for a moment all your relationships. If you start thinking in honorable ways about people, whoa, that's a complete different way of thinking, isn't it? What if you started appreciating people and value in your head? Instead of looking for the things, the flaws in them, looking for the things that they're not doing right, what if you just start appreciating them? What if you start looking at all the things that they're doing correctly? What if you just start focusing on all the good things about them and just start appreciating them in value? Wow, God loves that person. God's doing amazing things in that person. You know, they might not be where they're at, you know, supposed to be right now. They got a journey, but so do I. But I mean, you know, they're on their journey, but look how far they've come. And now we start talking to people from a place of honor. And guess what? That, my friends, is what changes lives. That's prophecy. Prophecy is seeing people as the finished work and not the unfinished work. The enemy wants us to see ourselves as the unfinished work, and then we start flowing out of the unfinished work for everybody around us because we're so busy comparing ourselves, and we start saying, you know what, I have problems, so everybody else around me's got problems, and it just messes us all up. So the first thing we got to do is first operate from the place of saying, wow, God loves me, and I'm just receiving that, and he has filled me up, and we just start operating from this place of saying, wow, I have all things that in God has called me to do, and then we start seeing that in other people. We start to have what are called sunglasses, which is basically seeing the sun in people around us. Now, whatever is just, it says, think on whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just. So what's just? Well, justice is right and wrong. This is really easy, because what's right is Jesus Christ. What's wrong is anything that is outside of him, right? So this picture of just, right, is really one of righteousness or right standing. The only possible way that we can get into right standing and righteousness with God is because of the sacrifice of his son. Can I get an amen? I mean, there's no possible way that we could ever get into the righteousness of God. There's nothing that we could possibly do to get in there except for the sacrifices of his son. So the more that we can accept the sacrifice of his son over us and for us, the more that we're going to have justice in our life. Because just like Cain and Abel, think of Cain and Abel, right? Abel gave the sacrifice that that God wanted, which was a sacrifice that was a picture. It was basically he gave the sacrifice of his son because only blood itself can actually atone for sins, right? And so Cain or Abel gave the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, and Abel or Cain tried to give the works of his own hand, right? He, and in fact, he tried to, he was the tiller of the ground, and so he was trying to, he was basically saying, God, I know this is what you want, but I want to give you this. And it just didn't work, because what happened was the sin was not justified, it was not atoned, it was not removed, it was not released, and so it started to crouch at the door of Cain's heart, and it sought to master him. And when it mastered him, he killed his brother. You see, this understanding of whatever is just, it only comes from the sacrifice of God's son for you. There's absolutely nothing we can do. We cannot strive for the righteousness of God. We can only receive the righteousness of God. But wow, what an amazing place it is when we realize that God has done everything necessary for us to come into his presence. There, what happens to us is we get transformed by thankfulness and praise because we were imbued by, wow, how much God loves me, how much he loves me, and how much he just flows through me, not because of anything I've done, but because of everything that he's done. It also tells us whatever is pure. So what is purity? Well, once again, purity is anything that's completely and utterly light. It's completely and utterly salt. Now, I want you to think on this for a minute. If Jesus Christ told us to be the light and the salt in the earth, then that would have to mean that we ourselves have been transformed into light and salt. There's no other way possible that we could be light and salt unless we ourselves have carried it, because the only thing that we can give is what God has received. How many people here, and this isn't a condemning word, but this is one of conviction, but how many people here see yourselves as light? How many people, when you see yourself in the mirror, you say, wow, I am light. I'm so fully filled up with the Spirit of God and the power of God and His Son. I'm so filled up by His love. I'm so approved and accepted and anointed that I could be the greatest call that He's calling us to. I could do everything that He's calling me to do, that I could go out into the marketplace and I could start speaking love and the light of God would just shine right through me, that He has just basically just transformed me into who He's calling me to be. Because when we start seeing ourselves like this, then we start really and then God is flowing through us, now everything kind of changes, right? We start getting excited about going out into the byways and the highways because we know that God is just moving through us. And that, my friends, is renewing of the mind. It's whatever is pure. He has made us pure. He has transformed us. He has made the ability for us to even come into His very presence. The very fact that we can hold the Holy Spirit inside of us means that we ourselves have been made pure. It means that we ourselves have been transformed. It means that He basically said, I'm going to take your sin on me. It's no longer counted to you. You're going to walk in righteousness and you're going to hold my very Spirit. How many people here would ever look at a temple that God owned and say, that's unrighteous? I wouldn't do that. That'd be crazy, right? I mean, if you knew that God was sitting in a temple, would you ever look at the temple that He chose to abode Himself into? Would you ever say, that's an unrighteous place right there? Now, I don't know about you, but I am not going to do that. But how often do we do that when we look in the mirror? Or how often do we accept those thoughts from the enemy that try to get us to think like that? Because it's utterly craziness to think that God would ever dwell Himself in unrighteousness. And the only reason we have righteousness is because He Himself has given us His. Now, whatever is lovely, here's that word love again. Whatever is lovely, this is amazing. So whatever attracts love, whatever is worthy of love, love itself is just, you know, this self-sacrifice, the ability. Jesus Christ showed us love when He said, I give up my life for you. He actually gave up His life for the enemies. The way that we come into the presence and the acceptance of God is realizing that we're the ones that nailed Him to the cross. I mean, literally, our sins put Him on the cross, and He would have died for us if we were the only one. But see, great is His love, so much so that even though we were not worthy of it, He loved us anyway. And doesn't our life reflect that? Isn't there people all around us that they pick on us, they prod on us, you know, they come against us. They don't understand what we carry. They don't understand what it is about us. And so they just continually come against us. But here's the amazing thing. You see, we carry fruit, and Jesus Christ gave us fruit so we could share it with the entire world. And so many people are saying, God, use me, God, use me, God, use me. And then as soon as we get picked on, we're like, God, why am I getting picked on? But here's the thing. You carry fruit to be picked on. The fruit that you have is called to be picked. And when you get picked on, when something comes against you that doesn't make sense from the natural perspective, but you respond from a supernatural perspective, you, my friends, are preaching the kingdom of God. When an unpeaceful situation arises and you come in with peace, and it makes absolutely, utterly no sense because it can't, because it's supernatural, because it's only because Jesus is in you, when you come from that place, now all of a sudden they're like, there is something different about you. I've never seen that before. Maybe you could tell me something. What kind of books are you reading? What is it that's different about you? I had a friend who, she went through some things, but she radically got transformed, and they came to her and they said, you know, what was it? What is it that kept you on top? And she said, Jesus. Because they wanted her to speak. They wanted her to tell the secret technique and tactic, whatever that she had learned. And when she said it was just Jesus, it was Jesus. Jesus totally and utterly, He transformed me. He kept me up, and He's continually just doing it for me. Well, they didn't want to hear from her anymore. They didn't want her to talk. But see, if we just get into this place, we say, you know what? Whatever is lovely, it doesn't matter what the world throws at me, because love is is loving people through their a misunderstanding. Jesus Christ, when He died, right before He died, He prayed for the forgiveness for every single person. If we look through the early Christian history, we see that happening over and over and over again in Christians. That, my friends, is what spread Christianity so quickly and so fast, is that people said, man, what happened to Bob? Man, Bob, I knew Bob a year ago. He was not like that. And now he's going, you know, he's willing to die for his faith. And then he's praying for people and he's saying, God, forgive him. What happened to Bob? That makes absolutely no sense at all. Well, that's because that's Jesus Christ. That's the supernatural kingdom being exposed to this kingdom because we have been transformed. Is everybody, do you guys see how powerful this is to realize when you start operating from this place and you're not trying to grab something that's already been given to you? See, the enemy tries to get us in our mind to think that we have to chase something, that we always have to chase this righteousness. We have to chase the call of God. But here God's saying, I already gave it to you. Stop running in front of me and start resting in me. Abide in me. He says that the only thing that we can give is when we abide in him. So whatever is commendable, whatever is excellent, excellence, this is such an amazing, powerful word. Excellence is us looking at something and saying that is the highest quality. Excellence is basically saying that is the highest quality. That is really high quality. That's worth in terms of value. That has an excellence to it. That it's a place of basically saying we're going to be top performance. We're going to do the very best that we can. We're going to walk in a place of excellence. It's basically, that's like the calling card of the kingdom. It doesn't necessarily mean our results, but it means our effort. It's the calling card of the kingdom that says, you know what? I want to work on this. I want to do this for the glory of God. I want to do this for the glory of the King. And it looks like it's in the small things. It's in the praise and worship music that starts, you know, starts the sermons and starts the worship here. You know, like we have two amazing and anointed praise and worship singers, right? We see it in just the way that the chat room itself has been carried out. It's this place of saying, I'm gonna walk in a place of excellence, not in my power, but God's power. And it says to us, if there's anything worthy of praise, so anything that you could be thankful for and praise God for, think on those things. Now, so that's our blueprint. Our blueprint is basically to focus on Jesus Christ, whatever's true, honor people above ourselves. Focus on the fact that we've been transformed. So we go out there and start just loving on people, whatever is excellent, and we focus on anything that we could possibly be loving and thanking God for. That's the blueprint. Those are the things that we should be thinking about. Now, let me ask you a question. If we accept this scripture as truth, which it is, but if we accept it as truth and we use this as our model for our thoughts, how many thoughts aren't in there? I don't see any depression. I don't see any worry. I don't see any anxiety. I don't see any fear. I don't see any lack. I don't see any lies. I don't see anything like that. All I'm seeing in this scripture here with this model is I'm seeing a place of basically saying God has given me everything I need. I'm only going to look at the power of God. I'm going to look at the things God is doing instead of the things God isn't doing. And I'm going to be praising God the entire way. I'm going to be looking at all the things that I'm thankful for and I'm praising him for. And I'm just going to be rocking. I'm just going to be just focusing on those things. I'm going to be just loving on God in that place of our mind. You see, if we have that mind, if we start protecting our mind with those thoughts, then anything that comes against those things, we could start kicking them out in the name of Jesus. We say, you know what? You didn't fit. You didn't fit the blueprint. Sorry, get out. In the name of Jesus, you need to get lost. See, that's cool because the Bible says that it's the spirits will have to succumb to the authority of the name. So all we need to do is believe in the authority of the name of Jesus and just keep saying, basically, you know, you need to get lost in the name of Jesus. Bible tells us if we resist the devil that he will flee. See, it doesn't even say that he's going to walk away quietly. He's actually going to flee. That means he's going to run away in terror. He's absolutely, completely terrified of you. So there's no reason for you to be terrified of him. You see, because the name of Jesus is above the name of all names. So as soon as we say, you know what, you need to get lost in the name of Jesus, that's when it goes. And it might not go right at first because it's going to try to stick around. And that doesn't even mean we need to command it again. All we need to do is just basically make it realize that, hey, it's got to go because it's done. The name above all names is just laid it out and it's over. 1 Corinthians 2:12 says, now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God. We ourselves, think about that. You've received the spirit of God that we might understand the things freely given us by God. There we go again. The things that God freely gave us, but we need the spirit of God to be able to understand them. It says, and we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. So we do not speak in normal words, but we speak in spiritual words. Because the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit God, for they are folly to them. They are foolish. And he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. We are not able to understand things unless they are spiritually discerned. You see, we cannot spiritually discern things of the Spirit unless we agree with the very fact that we carry the Spirit of God and that he gives us revelation of spiritual things. You see, until we get to that place, basically saying, I have the teacher, I have the instructor, and he's inside of me, and he's taking all these little pieces from the world, and the things that I need to know, he's spiritually interpreting for him. That's when I can start accepting spiritual things. But if I'm thinking that I'm going to do it with my natural mind, I am wrong. Because my natural mind cannot accept spiritual things. But it's okay, because what I'm about to share with you next, the spiritual person judges all things, but is himself judged by no one. Wow. That's powerful, isn't it? Judged by no one. How many people have ever felt judged? Bible here tells us that we will be judged by no one because we have the Spirit of God in us. And who judges God? But for who has understood the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him, but we have the mind of Christ. Now this, did that just say what I think it said? Did that just say I have the mind of Christ? Wow. So that means that my mind is aligned with the mind of Christ. Huh. That's kind of cool, isn't it? So let me put this all together. So God has transformed my heart. He's taken out that old stony heart, one that's continually focused on self-deception and wickedness, right? Because Ezekiel tells us that he gave us a new heart. Then he put in his Spirit inside of us, wrote the law of love on our eyes and our minds so that we might be completely and fully focused on just loving on God and loving on his people. And then he goes on to say, oh, by the way, you've also got the mind of Christ. Wow. Now, I don't know about you, but I have to say that we are supercharged up. There's no such thing as there's no such thing as me not having something, because I've got the mind of Christ. I'm completely and utterly filled by the grace of God. I'm completely, utterly filled by the power of God. I'm completely and utterly filled by the ability of God to go out in the world and transform it. I carry the mind of Christ. But we've got to receive it. We've got to accept this reality, don't we? We've got to say, you know what? What does it mean to have the mind of Christ? What does that mean? What does that even mean? How do you receive that? Here's how you receive it. Basically say, thank you, Lord. I have the mind of Christ. Now I'm going to start operating from the place of having the mind of Christ. I'm going to start believing that when I read your word, I'm going to get some supernatural revelation. In fact, I'm going to carry a notepad with me and a pen. So when I'm reading the Bible, I'm writing out some crazy, supernatural, powerful revelation that I can start sharing with people because I got the mind of Christ. In fact, I now have the mind of Christ, so when I'm listening to people, I can use this new mind that you've placed in me to be able to spiritually discern the things that they might be going through. And then not coming at them from a place of condemnation, but from a place of grace and love. And saying, you know what, I know what the enemy's trying to put on you, but that is a lie. Because Jesus Christ has done everything, and I see you completely differently. I honor you. I see you as completely valuable. In fact, I just want you guys to know this right now. I am empowered to transform world changers. That is my calling. My calling is basically saying, you know what? You're a world changer. Go out there. And every single person in here is a world changer. You all are world changers. In fact, can we all agree that Jesus was a world changer? Would everybody agree with that? Jesus is a world changer. Everyone? Yes? All right. So Jesus Christ is a world changer. And inside of you, you've got Jesus. And you've got the mind of Christ. And you've got the Spirit of God. So you've got what Jesus had. You've got it. In fact, Jesus went so far as to say that when I go to the Father, you're going to be able to not only do the things that I did, but even greater things. Because I'm with the Father. Wow. That's a promise. I mean, wow, that is a promise. For him to say, not only will you do the things that I did, but you're going to do even greater. That's quite a promise. And he wasn't squeamish about making it either. And he paid a great sacrifice to be able to give us that promise. You see, we are called to influence and transform the world around us. The world that you live in, the world that God has placed you in, the purpose and the call that he's placed inside of you, you have received everything necessary to go out there and do it. I don't care if it's a book. If it's a book that you've got written on your heart, I want you to write a little bit every single day, and you're going to see the power of God move. You see, we get from this place of saying, God, I need you to move, and start saying, God, I believe you already have. We start saying, you know what, God, I already believe that you've moved because you've already transformed me and you've given me everything to be able to go out there and do everything that you're calling me to do. You see, if God gave you the vision, he gave you the provision. If it's his bill, if it's his will, it's his bill. You see, he has fueled us and given us everything necessary to fulfill the call on your heart. But the very first place we got to come from is basically saying, you know what? The things and the purposes and desires that he's placed on me, those are good. Those are in line with his kingdom. His kingdom is going to move through me. And I am called to just basically transform the world around me. I'm called for his kingdom in heaven to be moving through me here on earth. And that becomes our call, that becomes our cry, that becomes just basically our daily purpose that we live. And God says that if you do that, I will give you freely all things. Amen. Father, I just pray and I just thank you, Father, for your word that you have shared with me to be able to share with everybody. Father, I just know that you're just moving through this audience right now. I know that you have set apart the world changers, that their interest level completely and utterly just changes who they are. They have a distinction among them right now because you've placed something inside of them, Father. And they are free to do what it is that you've placed inside of them. The enemy is a liar. They are not chained because whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And Father, right now I know that you have equipped every single one to do everything that you're calling them to do. Yes, Father, I know that we need to continually renew our mind and continually see the finished work in each other so that we might be able to run across that finish line with one another, that we might hold each other close and realize that it's not about me, but it's about we, that we might see each other, that your purpose and your call in each other, that we might see just that you are moving and flowing and grooving, and that we might give freely all things that you have freely given to us, that the gifts that you've given us, that we might use them to unlock, inspire, and transform and renew the believers, the brothers and sisters, our family, that we might be able to do everything that you're calling us to do, that we might be able to receive everything that you've given us. Father, turn us into receivers. I mean, we're already receivers, but turn it up a couple notches. Father, I pray for a renewing of the mind right now, that of just seeing ourselves differently, seeing ourselves through the finished work of your lens, seeing ourselves as receivers, seeing ourselves as channels of your kingdom here on this earth, seeing ourselves as being here as an influence of world changers here, that we might just, when we see ourselves, we see the renewed transforming work that you've done, that we see that when we lay hands on people, that they're going to recover, that we see the power that you have, that you've flowed through us, that when we see somebody hurting, that we're going to love on them, that when we see people who are in depression, that we speak against that depression, Father, that we might be able to see the finished work first in ourselves and then in others, that we might be able to see your grace empowering us and empowering everybody around us, that from that place of love, that we will not try to reach for something thinking that you haven't given it to us, because that was the lie that the enemy used against Adam. We will not fall for that lie because you, Father, have just taken us by your love, and you hold us close, and we abide in you, and we know that you love us, and because we know that you love us, we know that you've got good thing for us, and so we're not trying to grab something. We already got it, and we're keeping it, and we're holding on to it, and we're going to flow from that place. And Father God, I just right now set everyone free in the name of Jesus. And I just have everybody just see themselves as equipped in the name of Jesus. And I release them to go out in the world around them to transform their world. In Jesus' mighty name, may your kingdom come. May your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Hallowed be thy name forever and ever. May the world see your glory. May they see the transformation that you've had. May they see your power, your abundance, and your supernatural spiritual fruit. That if the world tries to come against us and persecute us, that we'll be standing there with the good things to give to them. That they might see that we have peace. That they might see that we have joy. That they might see that we have love. Everything that they're out there searching in books and drinks and drugs and women and men. Everything that they're sitting out there trying to fill up, Father God. May they see that we carry it because you've given it to us. May we be the equipped saints that you're calling us to be. May we be the priests and the kings and the queens that you're calling us to be. May we be the Caesars, the fruit bearers. May we continually abide in you and bear fruit. And when the world tries to pick on us, we say, go ahead and pick on us because we got all the fruit you need. And we know the healer and we know the provider. And there's nothing that's going to come against us and not going to be that you're not going to be able to heal and you're not going to be able to restore in the mighty name of Jesus.